So welcome to all, and today we had a little switch into the lesson. So the second slot will be myself doing it while this morning you had one of the seminars concerning examples of visual analytics environment that can be constructed by the good use of the concept that we are looking. So we left last time looking briefly at how to govern the layout part of the environment and given the rules. Then we introduced the scales. So we got a powerful way, both in terms of concepts, so mapping a domain to a range, whatever it is, data to data, data to visual space more generally, and its different fashions. So quantitative scales, eventually ordinal scales, and eventually the two mixed parts. So in order to govern at any moment, any kind of continuous or discrete domain and or scale range. We saw how one of the application, apart from the pure numeric mapping, usually is in color scales, and we even briefly introduced color viewer. And finally, we stopped introducing the fact that scales, similarly to what, for example, data binding does or enter and exit selection does, just prepare our data, but does not do any, but they do not do any more than this. Okay, so they just prepare the ground to the rendering. Okay, while simply defining the scales does not render anything. Additionally, another important aspect that we saw is that usually the definition of a scale can be split into two parts. Definition of the range that usually is in visual space, so can be usually defined at the beginning of our code, and instead deferring the completion of the scale by defining the domain all the time that in which the domain is data dependent, meaning that that part of code must be included in the callback function that get executed after the full loading of the data as complete. So having done this brief recap, on the other end, we can start looking at a concept that usually is very tied to scales, and so how to represent it explicitly to the user. Why? Because in most cases, scales represents the kind of visual mapping that we are using, and in most cases, it can support human interpretation of the chart. Okay, so if the chart contains a color scale, maybe in the legend, we want to show the scale in order to allow the human to interpret the variation in colors. And or in the case in which instead the scales are purely quantitative, so encompasses numeric domain and ranges, the other kind of auxiliary element that is used by a human to interpret those results comes in the form of axis, okay? Where axis can be the axis of a Cartesian plane or a Cartesian space, and or can be the axis of a radar chart or the axis of a parallel coordinates, and so on. Okay, so not necessarily only tied to Cartesian space. So given the importance of this concept, again, libraries, the tree library provide us some help in doing it. And here in this slide, we see how we can easily define scales in a Cartesian plane. Let's look at how it works. So normally the module that you are using is the D3.axis, okay? And for example, for creating an axis for whatever scale we have defined, in this example, we will consider classic Cartesian scales, so scales that are mapping data to classic x-axis and y-axis, but more generally, our scales could define this mapping whatever we like. And all the time we have a scale, we can associate to it an axis. How we do it? First of all, we need to define the scale itself, okay? And the scale itself, we already saw how we can do it, okay? So we simply define the kind of scales in terms of domain and range. Then when we want to define an axis for it, it's quite easy. We just simply need to invoke one of the functions of the D3.axis module. There are several. One example is axis bottom, and pass to it the kind of scales, okay? So in this example, the first very example, define a variable, call this function, and very important step, pass to the function declaration the scales to which it has to be mapped. So here the y variable is the variable that contain the scale definition, okay? So we cannot define any axis without passing to it the related scales. And then the scale that we want to map to each axis is up to us, and we don't have any limitation. After we have did it, the other important part is that we need to invoke the scale, okay? Even in this case, the axis, sorry. Even in this case, having defined this variable does not render the scale. It's just prepare its mapping. And for example, here we choose the axis bottom because the axis bottom is a function that define an axis and then set up its ticks to be oriented towards the bottom part of the screen. Okay, so for example, like in this case, if we want to map an x-axis, we probably use this. If you want to map a classic y-axis, here we have to invoke, for example, axis left. Okay, why? Because in common Cartesian plane, the ticks of the y-axis are oriented toward the left part of the screen. At the same time, I already said to you that this just prepared data. After that, if we want to render the axis, we need to explicitly invoke it. So explicitly invoke its rendering. This is something that we never encountered up to today. And normally in D3, when we want to explicitly render something, we need to invoke the general command called dot call. Okay, so the instruction dot call then take an argument, and the argument can be of many different forms given the generality of the command, simply force the renderer to invoke the drawing of the element that is passed to it. Okay, so the very moment in which we invoke dot call, the tree dot axis bottom of the x scale, where x is this variable, for example, so the definition of the scale. And we have invoked this into an element, into an element of the page, in this case, probably a div, with the class.axis, but it could be whatever. We obtain the explicit rendering of the axis, okay, following the setup that we did for the axis. And for example, if we choose this form, we can then go stylize our axis. And here, all the style parts are done, as you can see here, completely into CSS, okay? So we retain the name of the element on which we explicitly drawn the axis. We take the two keyword, the pattern line, because an axis has only these two parameters, the path itself or eventually the line, depending on how it is done. And then we define several of its presentation property. So for example, we don't want any fill in it, just the line. We want a black stroke. We want a kind of rendering that is crisp edges. That means that eventually it avoid aliasing effects and make the rendering more, you know, more cleaner with respect to its properties. So we have to remember that anytime we want to create an axis, we just need to invoke the related function of the D3 axis module, pass to it the scale, invoke it explicitly, and then stylize it. Consider also that if we save this dotted execution in a variable, we can even continue it by stylizing directly in the code with the attribute commands, the same field. Okay, so we can choose to do it in the CSS file, or we can choose to do it directly in code. That's up to us. As the properties that we saw, even others exist with the axis in D3. And one of the more important is the concept of the ticks. So ticks are simply reference inside the axis that allow us to, as human, to understand what we are reading, what a possible value of some point is in a scatter plot, or what is the highest peak of a line chart in a line chart, and so on. And clearly, our interpretation is helped if we visualize reference lines. And reference lines, at least in their minimized form, take the form of ticks. Okay, so element that graduate our axis and help us understand on the large how what is the numerical value of some visual element that we select. So they are very important to be defined. And in D3, they are one of the first most important part to define when after having declared and rendered an axis. Now, normally, as you see here, the ticks can be a property of the scale or can be a property of the axis. Okay, so that's up to us to decide. In both cases, and it's very important, we have two main ways of defining them. The first one is simply to invoke the ticks command on the scale or on the axis just defined. Okay, and eventually pass a number of it. The number that we pass is what we would like to have in terms of number of ticks, and work on the assumption that those ticks will be generated equally distributed with respect to what the scale imposes. Okay, so for example, if we look at this and we have a domain that ranges between 12 and 24, and we define that our axis must be composed of 5 ticks, it will go equally splitting this element with 5 values, resulting in 6 interval that will be equally spaced into the domain. At the same time, the people that paid more attention to this slide probably would have noted that here, unfortunately, we don't have 6 interval corresponding to 5 ticks. Okay, so the ones that we asked, but we have instead 2, 4, 6, 7 of those elements. Clearly, we can say that the first and the last could or could not count, but in the end We will have reference for all those points that are 7 and not the 5 that we requested. This is not an error, but instead is a property to pay attention in D3. So as reported into the slide, we can express a preferred number of ticks, like we did it here as a parameter of the ticks command. But unfortunately, this is, at least in this form, this is not a strict imperative command, meaning that the execution of the ticks command will look at the potential application of what we asked to the kind of scale on which we have defined it and decide by itself if it is adequate or not. Okay. And if not, our request will be overwritten by the best choice that the library takes. Okay, so for example, we asked 6 equally spaced interval in this domain, but the library, for whatever reason, chose that 6 is not a good number and expanded it towards 7. Okay, meaning that while the library tried to be as much as possible compliant with what we ask, this is not a deterministic execution. Okay, so we can put the value that we like, but we are not assured that that value will be respected. So this is something to keep in mind when you will work with Axis in order to avoid to consider it an error in your code and losing a lot of time, but instead is somehow a feature that try to apply perceptual principles to the correct definition of ticks. The rationale behind it is maybe 5 create too large interval that make difficult to visually inspect the axis and assign a point to to its correct values by simply looking at 5. Instead, if we put 7, probably it is considered in this case more adequate, okay? So more in line with what the human eye is able to. So it's not a fuzzy behavior of the library, but it is a behavior that responds to perceptual principle, to a perceptual principle, but at the same time that can overcome our decision. And clearly, it is important to remember. This is, on the other hand, and we will see probably in this code, another way to do it, okay? So let's say, for example, that we exactly want 5 ticks for our reason, because we absolutely need only 5, and we don't like this behavior. If it is the case, we can force this choice not by expressing the number of ticks, but by expressing explicitly and passing it as a parameter still of the ticks command, the vector, so the unidimensional vector of the tick values that we want to pass. At that point, so a vector similar to this one, for example, okay? Maybe just the first value, 12, 14, and then we close the square bracket. If we pass directly the vector of values obtained by ourselves, meaning that maybe we have another piece of code that takes the domain, evenly split it in the part that we like, and return us the split values, the vector of the split values resulting from it, and we pass it directly as a parameter to the ticks command, this time this command will be executed in an imperative way, meaning that it will be taken the exact tick values that we defined, and those are the ones that will be used to render the axis. So all the time that we need to do it, we have these two ways of behaving. Or we trust the library, but at the same time express a reference value of the number of ticks that we want, and then accept that they can be slightly higher or slightly lower, depending on the perceptual principle on which the library work, or we instead obtain by ourselves the vector of ticks values, pass them to the ticks command, and we will have exactly what we express. At the same time, this is true for a lot of continuous and discrete value, but we have to remember that we can pass to a scale, to an axis, even the kind of format for the ticks values that the kind of scale expects. One of the very common ones are the time format, so interpreting a number not as an absolute number but as a date, so trying to avoid to express a date as the number of milliseconds that have passed between 1970 and today, but instead having them well structured according to a classic time format, at least in English countries that have months, day, year, and then times of the day, and or a general format for numbers like the D3 format that allow, for example, to cap real values to a certain number of digits. Okay, so avoid to have a real values that is expressed with 20 decimal digits, into our visualization that will be absolutely unreadable and we will be disturbing. But instead, capping it to the kind of, let's say, manageable number of digits, of decimal digits, all without having a side effect on it. So, not avoiding rounding the value, so keeping the value in its pure form in the data without any round, and at the same time, instead, having its visual representation correctly capped in order to be helpful and not to be disturbing, given its sheer amount of decimal digits. So all the concept that we look at are summarized in the piece of code that we see here. Okay, so again, in order to recap those examples, so and to recap what concerns scales and axes, here we have a little piece of code that can help us. So we have the definition of the and the selection of the SVG area that we want to use. We have the selection of width and height of the area and origins. Okay, so another way of expressing margin, you can see here the center is displaced by 40 pixels on each of the direction. And then we have a width and a height of the area that in this case are fixed and are 200 pixels per 200 pixels. Again, I want to stress that this center is not this center, but is this center, because the center must always be considered from the top left corner. Then we go define our scale. Okay, now here there is a little old notation. Here there is a scale linear that is all together. And we define their domain and their range. So for the X scale, we have a domain between 0 and 1 in this case, a continuous because this is linear, so real, and a range that is between 0 and CW. So between the origin and, you know, the width of our visualization of our area, SVG. On the other end, here we have the Y scale that is defined in the same way. And the domain goes again from 0 to 1, and the range goes from 0 to CH. So from 0, that is here, to CH, that is here. Okay, again, following the classic way that we define. And so we already defined our scale. Then we have the classic appending of the grouping for all the rendering. Again, here we didn't have rendered anything, so we created the what we introduced last time, so an abstract group that takes the whole visualization and in fact that is created and translated by exactly say x, that is the displacement for the center, and cy plus ch, that is even more interesting because we are displacing it by this quantity, effectively aligning it with the rest of the drawing and with the correct way in which we interpret our visualization. And why it is done? Because this group will encompass this part of the visualization, okay? So normally, if we want to encompass the whole visualization, we just have to displace it by the first two coordinates, okay? Instead, this is an additional grouping that is created just to encompass all the visual element that represent an axis. In this case, we are doing it for the x-axis, and so we displace the group by simply the displacement on the x-axis, that is say x. So coming from here, there will be the natural full drawing to here. And then instead displacing on the y-axis from the displacement that put it at the, let's say, origin, real origin of our drawing, down to the real origin of the Cartesian. After we have defined this G that we save the reference in the variable XG, we go defining the axis, okay? So we write a variable, we pass the D3 dot axis, this is updated, so SVG is not here anymore, it's D3 dot axis. We pass this time explicitly the scale, we can do it. This is the other way in which we can initially define an axis. So we attach to it its scale, we attach to it directly its orientation, and we attach to it the number of ticks that we potentially would like for it. There will be 4 ticks, okay? After we are doing it, we see the other way in which we can invoke an axis. Instead of calling explicitly the axis, we invoke the axis variable on the G that we created, and it will go random, okay? Obtaining this part of the story. So we will obtain the x-axis. As we can see again, we obtained 6 ticks and not the 4 that we asked for the principle that I told you, but eventually this could be fine. On the other end, instead, we repeat the same thing for the other axis. So we define a group for it. This time we displace it just by x and y because we want to cover this part of the graph. So we have a group that will encompass whatever we draw here, as we did for the previous one. We define the y-axis in the same way. So the 3 dot axis, take out SVG that does not exist anymore. The 3 dot axis, scale, we pass the y scale that we defined here as a parameter to the scale. We orient it left. And this time we don't pass the number of ticks, but we pass directly the tick values. Okay, and to the tick values method, we pass the vector of the values that we like. So we want just 3 ticks, one representing 0, one 0.5, and one, and the final 1.0. And in fact, what we obtain correctly is that in this case, we have exactly 3 ticks and nothing more or nothing less, because we explicitly asked for. So in this piece of code, we saw again an element that is quite straightforward, and that will be present in many of the visualization that we will do. So we will first define the scales, the ferret or complete, in this case they are complete, and then we go define the axis. Please pay attention that in order to draw an axis, this related scale must be complete. What does this mean to us? It means to us that even for the axis, we can defer code, but we have to know where to defer and how. So we said that here we have the definition of the axis. For defining an axis, the scale could not be complete, okay? So we can define an axis even in the part of code that is not loading data, okay? The only condition that we need to respect is that a scale must exist in order to be passed as a parameter. But this scale can be incomplete at that moment, meaning that maybe I have defined the variable, I've passed one between the domain of the range, one of the two and not the other, or maybe none of them in case you know I want to avoid scale, but the reference to the scale exists. If the reference to the scale does not exist, I cannot define an axis. On the other hand, if the scale is incomplete, I cannot invoke the axis, okay? Why? Because we said before that invoking the axis means executing whatever is in its definition, and so means evaluating them. And if the scale is not complete, there is nothing to evaluate, okay? Because the scale will not do how to construct, for example, ticks, how to be mapped into the range, and what values of the domain must be used. On the other hand, this gives us a way to defer code, meaning that we can defer the creation of the scale before data loading, we can defer the definition of the axis before data loading, even with incomplete but existing scale, and then instead, inside the data sensitive part of our code, so in the famous callback function, we must first complete the scale's definition and then simply invoke the axis that we already defined previously. This is an efficient way of doing it. It's not necessarily mandatory. So for beginners, someone could even choose to do whatever I wrote here, exactly all inside the callback function of the data to avoid the problem. It's less efficient, but still functional. Absolutely, in the case of a data loading process, we cannot put all this code outside the callback function from the data loading. Otherwise, nothing will work, okay? And eventually in this slide, you will find this big red cross evidencing you simply that some of that syntax is outdated. I already told you, for example, that right now to define the axis, it is the d3.axis module and not anymore the d3.svg.axis. But those are minor errors. So practically, this means that any time that we define scales in a visualization, so we are defining visual mapping in a visualization, we should ask us, even before going on, what we need to provide the human user to interpret those mappings, okay? And so if this mapping is Cartesian, I need to provide the reference line, so axis and ticks. If this mapping is qualitative, like in the case of a color scale, I need to provide a legend in which I will draw the colors that are of which is composed my color scale, and I will assign to them a value that in an ordinal case will be an ordinal label, and in a continuous case maybe have ticks too. Okay, that maybe ranges from zero value to one value in a normalized scale, like all those color scales work. But this is a very important preliminary step that must always be done, okay? It can be done in this phase. So first of all, we will follow a correct order in the rendering. And second one, we will avoid the case in which we introduce a mapping, but we do not introduce the legend that is needed or the reference that is needed to interpret it. And this is done in this order. So our orders start to become more complex than before. First, we cure the layout, then we cure the margin definitions and the correct positioning of the drawing. Then we define all the visual mappings, so all the scales that we need. And after them, we define all the references that are needed to interpret them. In our cases, we saw true axes and eventually true legends, where axes are no more, are no more significant. If we follow this step, we probably will have an empty drawing like this one that simply represents the way in which we need to interpret it, okay? So now we know that it is a Cartesian plane. Probably we know that it supports something in between a line chart or a scatter plot, for sure not a bar chart, because ticks are continuous. And at the same time, we don't have anymore still any data plotted, okay? This is the correct way of going on. So after we've done all those things, finally we can start things about the data to represent. And in order to manage them, we need to be practical with the primitives of the language that we are using. And given that we are using scalable vector graphics, we need to have a brief introduction to the standard itself. Differently from W3C standards for HTML and or for interactors and or for style, presentation style of an element, the scalable vector graphic format, while standard, is still less known with respect to the others. So what are the basics of this standard? We first see the most basic primitive that allow us to obtain the very basic figure. And we start by one that we quite encountered because it is similar yet not equal to an SVG area, that is the rectangle. So a rectangle in SVG is expressed in this way. So with four mandatory properties and two auxiliary properties. The four mandatory properties are the coordinate of its top left corner and its width and height. So if we define in this case statically, because this is a static rect tag into HTML in this format, and clearly we give to it correct values because here all are zero, we obtain a rectangle. Okay, and then clearly we can stylize it. The circle form, we already encountered it, even easier, just the coordinate of the center and the radius. And those are all the properties. Okay, where here instead we have even a slightly displacement with respect to the coordinate Rx and Y. Here instead, all the parameters are mandatory. So coordinates of the center and its radius. Then we have the line, that is another basic primitive of SVG standard that is defined in pure mathematical form. So by simply defining the two points in terms of x1 and y1, x2 and y2, in which this line, or better, this segment must pass, okay? And we will get a line itself. Clearly with those name, if you remember, we used the keyword circle in our initial example. The same is true for when we want to define a rectangle using rect and when we want to define a line using line. And eventually another primitive, a little bit more surprisingly, is the text. So a text is a primitive of the SVG standard in which we just need to define only the position in terms, again, of top left corner of the text that we want to insert. Interestingly, even here, optionally, we can define a displacement with of the text with respect to that point, that of the X and the Y, and eventually, even if less visible here, an anchor, okay? So we can define an anchor in terms of which part of the text will be attached to its top left corner. If we put the start, will be attached at the beginning of the text, but we could have put end, and we would have attached the top left corner here. So the text would have been trailing with respect to the top left corner of the text. Quite important aspect is that the text defined in SVG is a vectorial text. Okay, so we can apply all the vectorial transformation that we can apply to a general geometric shape. And it is quite interesting because it differentiates it from the text that you can simply write into the between two tags, an opening and a closing tags in HTML. Okay, those are still text, but those text cannot be managed in terms of vectorial element, meaning that no transformation is applied to them. Why it is important to us to have vectorial text? Simply because sometimes it can help us in better shape our visualizations. So for example, we would like to give an orientation to the text, like for example, this text that we see here, because maybe it helps avoid overlapping between labels of a very dense axis, okay? And so at that point, an orientation, giving the text an orientation, maybe plus 45 degrees or minus 45 degrees, could help in avoiding overplotting and intersections between text labels, okay? We can do this only if we specify text, the text that we want to put, for example, as the label of our ticks into an axis, as a SVG tag, okay? Again, in order to do it, we will use the keyword text, and so when we ask to append a text element, all the time that we write append text, we will have the creation of a vectorial text. Quite interestingly, those are the main primitives. What that we mean is that they have a direct reserved command in the SVG standard, so not in D3, that univocally identify them without any doubts or other consideration. On the other hand, the standard presents additional element. And here in this picture, you see in a compact way, pretty much all the elements that exist in the SVG standard and their properties with respect to classic vectorial transformation and vectorial function. Okay, this chart must be read from right to left, meaning that to the right there are the most basic element and to the left there are the most complex element. And as you can see, it is a hierarchy eventually, okay? As the full root of the hierarchy, we have the SVG area. You see here, this is the command that we now know quite well, okay? While instead on the other part of the hierarchy, we have the primitive. Some of them we already saw, the circle, the line, the text and the rect. Additionally, this is a little richer. We see that even an ellipse is a basic construct of the SVG standard. And eventually we have three additional primitives that are interesting in the form of Polygon and Polyline, okay? Or with some of them we will get them briefly. So here we have the bottom layer of the hierarchy, where here we have the root of the hierarchy. Rising from the bottom toward the top, immediately after the basic behavior, we have the grouping. So the concept of the G groups, abstract element that eventually are optional. And all the time that in this chart you see this line that overcome an element means that in the hierarchy it is optional, okay? And effectively you can see that we could have an SVG draw that encompass all those five layers in form of different element for each, or eventually we can have simply an SVG that is just composed by the SVG area. Why? Because if we go from bottom toward, from top toward the bottom, we encompass, we encounter the SVG and it is mandatory, then we can bypass these two levels, then we can bypass all these two levels and get directly to them. So an SVG element that has just one area is a valid SVG element. On the other hand, no element can exist without an SVG area to which it belongs. And this is a concept that now become clear and that we introduce it as a, you know, as a statement of faith at the beginning, saying that we cannot draw anything without an area. And now we have the rationale for it, because in the hierarchy of SVG, an SVG area is mandatory, okay? On the other hand, instead, we can choose to add whatever other combination on the remaining layer. And so we can add primitives for drawing, or we can add abstract element that allow us to group and consider all together like a sub hierarchy, all the elements to apply transformation. So maybe I want to translate a very complex draw, like maybe some of the prototypes that were shown you today with respect to cybersecurity domain, and it can obtain a very easy way of translating multiple elements that are grouped into one of the G group. On the other hand, we have another family of elements that instead govern presentation aspect of the SVG structure. One of the most known is the clip path, so the capability to have a drawing and to have a drawing clamped by a clip path, meaning that I have somehow an implicit border that cut out elements that go outside it, okay? Again, those are abstract. So for example, the clip path is never visible, okay? I don't see it, even if it exists into the DOM representation. And what it does is to clamp a certain drawing that maybe will extend much farther than it in an area that is not visible, but that I defined in order to clamp that drawing and make them correct, okay? Think about a chart in which you have horizon lines that will go all outside the draw, and you have a hidden clip path that simply cut those lines into the visible viewport, okay, or in the visible subarea, the visible deep that you have, in order to avoid the overextension of the drawing that keeps intact its geometric semantic, but that is adapted to the visible region in which I want it to stay, and not overextending toward the full viewport. And eventually we get back to the SVG. On the bottom part, instead, you have the same elements. You see here, eventually the SVG, the G, that those elements called a definition does not have any properties. They are used as they are. So as I told you, govern the presentation part of an SVG. And all the primitive plus style and attribute that are two properties that you can touch are here classified with respect to the kind of geometric transformation that we can do on them, both in terms of positioning them into the drawing or sizing them into the drawing. Let's look at some examples. Let's take the SVG, for example. The SVG does not respond to any of the positioning, as you can see here. So we cannot apply any transformation on the SVG. We cannot translate an SVG area. We cannot assign an origin to an SVG area, and so on. As you can see, all those geometric transformations are not applicable to. Only one transformation is applicable, that is the sizing, in terms of defining a width and a height, okay? And that's the reason why all the time we have defined an SVG area, we never give it an X and Y coordinate, simply because we can't. It is not envisioned by the standard, but we just assign to them a width and a height. And in order to overcome an eventual positioning problem, we first define in the layout a div to accommodate it fully, having it implicitly positioned at the absolute zero, zero value of that element, in this case of that div. Okay, so this gives you guidelines. You will never be able, given an SVG area, to express a direct position of it. Okay, and so you could never have, for example, a div in which you have two SVG areas, because they will not be repositioning among them. You cannot do that. On the other hand, we know that for it, it exists only the capability to define a width and a height numerical. Let's look at the group instead. As we already remember, for the group, we cannot give a width and a height. We already encountered it, if you remember. Even here, we create the group, while we never give to it a width and a height. On the other hand, we give a translation. Why don't we give a position? Simple. Because even for the G, we cannot position it. Okay? So we cannot say a group must begin at this position, X and Y, and have this other. Unfortunately, we can. But differently for the SVG area, we can translate it. This is possible. And that's why every time that we define a group, we can then move it to the kind of area that we want it positioned, expressing it into a transform translate operation, because this is, in terms of positioning, the only geometric transformation and more generally operation that we can do. On the other hand, instead in sizing, we didn't see it, we can even scale it, okay? So we can scale a group with respect to the kind of area that it must encompass. And so all the time that we want to position a G, we can only have a combination of translation and scaling. One for the positioning, the scaling for the size. As you see, the standard and how the standard works tend to become pretty clear now. So the more the element is near the root, the less fine-grained geometric operation I can apply. The more instead the element of the standard is towards the bottom of the hierarchy, so on the right part, the more I start to gain way of expressively define its property. So for the rect, this time we can position it, and for the text too, on top of the translation, and more of that, we can scale both, and only for the rect, we can even assign a width and a height, so a well-defined size, okay? So the rect is the first element that allow me to explicitly position it and size it. The text allow me to position it explicitly and eventually only to scale it. But it is fine by us, because if we allow a general explicit definition with the line of the text, we will probably come into distortion effect, okay? So the standard avoid us to do it, but simply allow us to scale it, where scale usually keep intact the aspect ratio of the element. Then we have the line that we will see briefly, line and path. We still don't know what they are. We will see it briefly in a brief time. That allow us to translate them, to expressively define where they pass. For the line, we already saw. To pass a data to the path, we will see why. And eventually, for both of them, just to scale them without explicit sizing. Why? Because they are linear elements, so no, they don't have a size, they have just a length eventually. Then for polygon and polyline, we again alone have the capability to translate them, and this time, more interestingly, to define the points to which they pass. Why? Because they have in the name to be poly element, meaning that they will pass through multiple control points. On the other hand, we can just scale them when we go to sizing. But it is interesting because we first define them in a little representation, then we can scale to the kind of sizes that we like. Finally, we have the circle that we already saw. So we can directly position it, commanding its center and translating it. We can assign to it a size to its radius, and we can eventually scale. And the ellipses that work almost in the same way, meaning that in the positioning is exactly the same, and in the sizing instead allow us to define the control point of the ellipses that allow us to. Finally, we have two other properties. Those two properties are not exactly of the SVG standard, but represent the classic attribute that we can touch for a HTML element, and so also for SVG. So defining an attribute for them, or defining a style property. Okay, so for style property, we cannot apply any transformation, but it is fine because style properties are exactly the kind of properties that are simply applied to an existing element, and they don't need any positioning or any sizing, okay? Meaning that it is unnecessary to do it. On the other hand, and on the contrary, for the attributes, it is true the exact opposite, meaning that if we define a non-standard attribute, or in general, an attribute property like we use it many times into D3, in principle, on that we can apply, we can pass whatever kind of this transformation. Okay, we saw already examples of it. If you look here, this is exactly what we mean. We mean that to the attribute property, we can pass whatever kind of geometric transformation. Okay, so having defined an element on which we want to apply an attribute, the attribute can include whatever of the positioning and sizing primitives that we have listed here. Okay. On the other hand, if instead of an attribute, we are defining a styling attribute that are presentation properties, normally they stay in CSS file, but we can define them even in D3 code and more generally in JavaScript code by using the style command. In the style command, we can never accommodate any of those of those primitives, okay? Meaning that the styling of an SVG, whatever it is, maybe the fill color, maybe the rendering mode, or the stroke, or whatever, are not properties that respond to a geometric nation. And for those reasons, we could never apply a translation of whatever things complex we created, maybe a hierarchy of primitives, using the style common. If we need to explicitly geometrically transform a group of primitives of whatever it is, I think that this morning you saw both the MED and Vulnus prototypes. If you remember them, they have their encoding complex object that are composed of many different primitives in SVG standard, and they are grouped together through several G's. If I want to translate one of those hierarchies, I have to use the attribute common. If instead maybe I want to change a presentation properties of them, maybe the behavior of a gradient, a color gradient, or maybe the way in which borders are stylized inside it, I don't have to refer to any of the geometric primitive for positioning and sizing, but instead to the classic properties that cascading style sheet standard defines. Additionally, and believe me, the uninformed combination of those elements can create whatever kind of drawing we need, okay? The question would be, oh, really, I need to do all those things? The answer is half yes and half no. What I mean? I mean that in principle, when we go to create our visual encoding, sometimes we just need to use only some of those concepts, which the main one are the SVG, the eventual grouping, and one primitive at the beginning, or two primitives together. And clearly, the more our visual encoding becomes sophisticated, maybe the more we need to mix and match those primitives together. On the other hand, the way in which it is done through the tree make it work again like a declarative approach, in which we declare what we want to obtain, and through a savvy combination we obtain the kind of visual elements we are interested. On the contrary, the SVG standard in its pure form, that is not the tree form, works in a much worse way, of which an example you can see it here. So this is an example of a drawing into the pure SVG standard. So normally in a pure SVG standard, all the elements are paths, and those paths are defined in a mini language that define in this way, through a property called D, the kind of low level drawing operation that are necessary to obtain the figure. Okay, so for example, here we read M, and then we read two numbers, okay? Very, very, not good to see numbers, okay? And then maybe at some other points into this long sequence, we see an L, for example, okay? It is here, and so on. This is a low-level programming language for SVG shapes and all the SVG drawing effectively tell us in its very low level form, like in programming we were coding directly into the metal, what we are using assembler, okay? So we are going down to the let's say most basic representation of an instruction, working directly with registers and whatever, even to obtain simple higher level operation. The same can be done in SVG, and this is the actual way in which it works. Okay, where maybe the M stands for move command, and for example, move the initial, the begins of the drawing. So to a coordinate that represent the initial point, absolute point from which this path, that is a complex line, will start the drawing. Okay, and eventually there is another command that I think, for example, that is an R, that if put it at the end of this long sequence, ask for linking the final point of the drawing to the initial one, for example, to obtain closed shapes, okay, instead of obtaining open paths that maybe start to a point and finish one. And clearly working in this way could be, you know, too difficult, and effectively it is too difficult to work in this way. Eventually, all the SVG elements, when they are rendered, are represented in this way. And if you look at some of the prototypes developed in D3 that are out in the web, and go looking into the inspector in the browser, you will see that anytime that you encounter shapes, they are done in this way. And if, for example, cut and paste these shapes and now put it into a browser using statically as an element of the body of the page, it will be rendered, creating the kind of shape, whatever it is, even very irregular, it represents. Normally, so this is the very low level form, and most of the times you will never use it, because as you can see, it is not programmer friendly. On the other end, we will see that there exist cases in which this is the only form that we will have. An example that I anticipate is that if, for example, you go inspecting the code of geographical representation of countries, maybe the kind of interactive geographical maps that right now all the newspaper, even the Italian one, have when you have an election, or when you have a natural disaster or whatever, that allow you, for example, to over to the Italy map and maybe select the Lazio region, and the Lazio region will get its border highlighted and you can click to select them or whatever. Those elements, those geographic elements, geographic element in their semantic, but geometric element in their rendering, are extracted from a GIS software, so a geopositioning software that is able to geometrically reconstruct, for example, their natural borders. Think about the Lazio region and how it is done in its very characteristic shape, and transform them into geometric shapes, okay? Because in those maps, when you select one of the Italian region or whatever, each of them is a geometric shape. You can consider them irregular polygons, okay? So polygons with a very strange number of edges, and not regular edges, but nonetheless, polygons themselves. At that point, if you go inspecting their codes, you will see that due to the way in which they are extracted from GIS software, and to have that shapes with a very high fidelity with respect to the real border that exists for those geographical borders, they are exactly represented in this form. So they are usually huge node of a DOM expressed in this way. Why? Because it will be too complex to express them as a combination of those elements. There will be no meaning. They are so irregular that you will need a sheer amount of work and of primitives in order to express them. And it is much more easier to express them directly at low level code, where you really command the cursor that that govern the rendering. And so you will find that those borders are very long sequence expressed in this mini language that clearly interpreted, as I showed briefly now, even if not in complete form, allow exactly to replay the whole rendering process of the line of the shape for all the little edges, irregular edges that of which it is formed. So while we never design an element in this way, sometimes we will call it to manipulate element expressed in this form. And so we know we had to remember that when we encounter this very ugly representation that starts with a path as a data and then this long list of low level instructions, geometric instructions, we will know that it is nonetheless an SVG element. And it is interesting because it is coded into the SVG standard. So the most generic visual element in the SVG standard are usually modeled through the path construct. Okay, and the path construct is probably the most general primitive of SVG standard, and as visible here, it is subject to translation and scaling because it creates a geometric shape, but it is the only element. Look at this line, that is very important. This is the only element of the whole standard that allow to get data that command its rendering. In this case, those data are not the data that we consider up to today. So they are not our data, so the domain data that we want to plot. Those data are in the form of geometric low level primitives that explicitly say the path how to be constructed. And again, it is the only element of the whole standard that allow to do it. No other element have a cross for the D property. Again, I want to stress that this D property is not the D property that we use to bind data to primitive. That is still valid for all of them, okay? This D is only a specific way of the SVG standard to instruct the rendering of a shape in its more free form possible, okay? In that case, only the path construct allow to do it. And finally, to close today's lesson, we can look instead how we can exploit the more general construct of SVG instead to build complex form without relying to this ugly representation. The first one is in the form of the line. Okay, so we saw here that we have a line element in SVG standard here. It is considered by D3, and D3 allow to define a line that is eventually expressed as a line SVG. How it is defined a line? Quite easy and quite convenient for us. A line requires to have just two scales, okay? Or at least a line in a plane, two scales. A line in a space, three scales, and so on. We have to define what governs the x coordinate of the line and what governs the y coordinate of the line by defining two different scales, normally two linear scales. Okay. After we have defined the two scales, we can define a line element in D3. Not this ugly, but much more compact. We create a variable, we launch the command D3.line, that is a function, and then we express. It's only two properties, so x and y, in the form of a function of our data that get first interpreted through the relative scale that we have defined. Okay, so things, for example, the feature one and feature two are two features of one of my data set. Okay, so semantic feature, not a geometric one. Okay, I define their mapping to the geometric xy plane. With these two scales, we now know how to do it, choosing two different mapping for two different feature of my dataset, maybe the weight and the height of a person, or the country and the amount in which a goods has been sold, or whatever couples of features you have in your dataset. We govern their mapping to the related scale, one feature by scale. And then finally, we simply construct. So ask the library to construct the line expressing the points to which it is composed, X and Y, as a function of our data, where our data are first interpreted through the related scale. As you can see here, we pass, for example, to the vector of X position for all the control points of this line, the result of the invocation of the of X-chord scale on the first feature of our dataset, and for the Y, for the second feature of our data. And in this way, we can obtain a continuous irregular line, however it is mapped into the plane, for example. And here, into this picture, you have an example of a parabola, okay? That is representing this line, where clearly are evidenced the control point of this line. Why? Because we said that the line, in the end, is governed by those two vectors. If we have 10 tuples in our data set, and each tuple have a feature one and a feature two, we will have 10 control points, okay? The line will be continuous, and eventually it will be possible even to define the way in which we smooth its behavior. But the control point that will define the behavior of those lines will still be the original 10 that we passed, okay? If at a later stage our dataset becomes a 1 million element, we will have 1 million control points, and so on. So for the line that are not paths, are still just lines, so more limited elements, instead of expressing it in very ugly form, we have a very compact form to represent them, that eventually again ask us to govern the mapping between the data, the scales, and the coordinate, the coordinate vector that govern the line in the form of control points. So not different at all from what we did for the scales, but this time we are not rendering a scale, but we are rendering our data. So those one allow us to render our data by binding them data and govern some of their properties by their data. If we want to be more general, we now have full capacity on lines, because we can define property of the lines in terms of their trend by simply using scales, and so managing the mapping between our data and the visual trend of the line that we want to create. If you think, for example, of a line chart, this is the best way to do it, okay? We can define our trend as a D3 line that takes exactly the two properties that govern those line charts, so a bidimensional chart that we already mapped if we designed it wisely at the beginning, creating the relative scale for the X and Y axis of our line chart. So assigning to X axis and Y axis the dimensions that we want to see, and then they will be the same when we go to draw a line. We will stop here because it is 15, and so we will restart next Wednesday again on morning, continuing the rules about drawing. If there are questions, you can write them in the chat. Otherwise, we will get updated the next Wednesday.